Let's bow our heads as we pray. Our dear gracious and kind Heavenly Father, we've come a long way for tonight, and you've been guiding us throughout the time, the permits and all the setups and all the helpers, and now the visitors who are here and our members. Please, I pray, that thy Spirit will continue to work with us. Help us, Lord, go before us. Impress upon those who need to hear the message and clear all the obstacles that's in their way. Bring them here safely, Lord. Abide with us. Your Spirit is so important, Father. Thy servant, Pastor John, is speaking. So please, through his words, impress and convict every one of us tonight and every night. Thank you for hearing and answering our prayers. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
At this time, we have a special music by the Himic Quartet. The Himic Quartet, the word Himic, represents the Tagalog word for tune, interestingly. I think you didn't know that. But the spiritual name of the group is H-I-M-I-G, which is Him I Glorify. They choose to glorify God in their singing. We pass the time to them.
Was calling even then, and even though it took dying to survive, I never felt so much alive. For I am crucified with Christ, and yet I live. Trust will never ask for more than I can give. For it's not my strength, but His. There's a greater sacrifice. For I am crucified with Christ, and yet I
I am crucified with Christ.
His cross will never ask for more than I can give. For it's not my strength, but His, there's no greater sacrifice. For I am crucified with Christ, and yet I live. And I will offer all I have, so that His cross will not in vain. For I found to live is Christ, and to die is truly. There's no greater sacrifice, for I am crucified with Christ, and yet I live. For I am crucified with Christ.
Shall we say amen once more? Amen. Praise the Lord. As blessed by the music. Before we invite Pastor John Lomacang up, I'd like to give a short introduction. Pastor John Lomacang has been pastoring for over 30 over years. He's the pastor currently in Thompsonville Seventh-day Adventist Church in Illinois in America. He's happily married to his wife, Angela. Maybe we can invite you to stand so people know. And let's give a warm welcome to her. Yes. Okay. Pastor Lomacang is also the director of World Evangelism in 3ABN, Three Angels Broadcasting Network, where he shares God's word as well as sings. We may or may not get to hear him tonight, but stay tuned for the rest of the night. You will surely get to hear him sing on one of these evenings. Tonight's topic, we have the theme from information to transformation. And tonight's topic is on the human nature. When we come to Christ, who are we? Over to you, Pastor John Lomacang.
Yes. Good evening, everyone. Oh, let's try that again. Good evening, everyone. Glad to see you here. It's good to be back in Singapore. We were here a little less than 2 years ago, and I'm so glad to be back. We're going to spend some time together on some very interesting topics. If you can switch my screen for me there, I'd appreciate it. I want to put the screen up on for us tonight. Yes, there it is. From information to transformation. Before I have prayer, let me just tell you a little bit about what this is all about. Each of us is born one way. But in order for us to get ready for eternity, we have to be another way. Now, this week, we're going to walk through these important topics, and I'll just share with you, give the overview very quickly. From information to transformation was born on the basis of, I started noticing that as a people, as a church, as leaders, we have become very information geared. You know, sharing information with people on different topics and hoping that the information would bring about transformation. But in so many instances, people were well informed intellectually, but they were not transformed spiritually. So what we're going to cover this week is tonight, one, human nature. Can you say that with me? What's the topic tonight? Human nature. So many of us are unaware of who we are. And if we are unaware of who we are, we cannot appreciate who we can become in Jesus Christ. After human nature, we're going to be covering tomorrow night the topic on desire. What does desire have to do with the forming of our character? Then we're going to cover the topic on the will. How important is desire and will when it comes to shaping who we can become? Then we're going to talk about justification. Many of you heard that word before, but we're going to dive below the surface and make it even a little more clear. Finally, on Sabbath morning, we're going to talk about sanctification. Why is sanctification necessary as we get ready for eternity? But tonight, we're going to begin with human nature, and we're going to learn about ourselves. We're going to find out some very interesting things about ourselves. Hopefully, what we learn encourages us to move in the direction that God has for every one of us. What encourages me is I know that every day I can become a better person than I was the day before. And I'll tell you the secret of that. But this evening, let's go to the Lord in prayer as we begin with our topic entitled Human Nature. Our loving Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for just the privilege and opportunity to share from your word. We know that as we share this information, we invite your Holy Spirit to be with us, that it will be more than just an intellectual exercise, but a time to look below the surface, to find out who we are, to understand who we can become. So, Lord, send your Spirit to speak to our hearts and lead us in the direction to become everything you know that we can be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, component one, human nature. There's a question that I'd like to begin with tonight, and the question is in Jeremiah chapter 13, verse 23. Very important because it starts by looking at who we are and who we can become. And as we begin tonight, what I'd like to do is I'd like to have you read this first scripture with me, Jeremiah chapter 13 and verse 23. Notice, it says, "Can the Ethiopian change his skin or the leopard its spots? Then may you also do good who are accustomed to do evil." Jeremiah the prophet is suggesting that The Ethiopian cannot change the way that their skin looks, and the leopard cannot change the way his spots appear. And the suggestion is, as the latter part of the verse brings to our attention, how can those who are accustomed to be evil, how can we be good? So many of us have tried to be good in so many ways. I mean, you may have heard the phrase, some people say, well, I have very good neighbors. Or you may have heard the question, people have said, why do bad things happen to good people? When I first heard that question, I responded with a question. You see, how can bad things happen to good people suggests that we are good and bad things happen to us. And tonight we're going to find out what the truth is. So I'm going to make you a little uncomfortable tonight, and then you're going to get more comfortable tomorrow night and more comfortable the next night. But I want to perform an x-ray. We're going to go below your surface. We're going to also perform a brain scan. I want to find out what's in your brain. I want to make you aware of the condition of your brain. We're going to also monitor your heart to find out what kind of heart you have. Because generally speaking, most of us think the best of ourselves. you know, we say, well, I'm a good person. We tend to think that everyone around us is the issue of life. We sometimes think that my world would be a lot better if people would just simply treat me differently. But tonight we're going to talk about human nature. What, in fact, is human nature? Let me illustrate it this way. Now, you know that this is not a real picture. How many of you have seen pigs fly? Raise your hand. I saw one hand. It must be a cartoon. Now, the reason I use this picture is because we know this cannot happen. There is no such thing in reality as flying pigs. From God's perspective, let me take it to the next level. Are you ready for it? There is no such thing as a person who is naturally good. But we tend to think of ourselves as, well, I have a lot of good things about me. Every one of us has the ability to do good things. You know, sometimes you would see a person needs help and we'll go help them with their groceries, or we might see a person that is having a difficult time walking the street and we perform a good deed. But I guarantee you that within every one of us there is this potential to be very evil. But we don't like to think of it that way. But if somebody does something that really irritates us, we often say they pressed our what? Our buttons. But you'll find that no one ever presses your buttons because they are your buttons. So tonight, let me begin by showing you the way that Jesus sees us. Now, putting this together, I'm a pastor. I love evangelism. I like to lead people to know the Lord better. But over the last, I'd say 7 or 8 years, I have altered the way that I do evangelism. Because generally speaking, we like to give people the truth about what happens when you die, the truth about the Sabbath, the truth about so many other doctrines in Scripture, and then we say, go ahead and live these beliefs in your life. And when they are confronted with failure, we wonder, why is it that they are unable to do what they have now been made aware of? Notice how Jesus puts it in the book of Mark, chapter 2. I'm going to kind of get out of your way so you can see it very easily. Mark chapter 2, let's look at this together. And I want you to notice the definitive nature of these scriptures, meaning they are not sometimes, but they are very definitive statements. And no one puts what kind of wine? New wine in old wineskins. Look what happens if you try to do that. Or else the new wine bursts the wineskins. The wine is spilled, and the wineskins are, what is the next word? Ruined. But new wine, look at this very definitive word, must be put into what? New wineskins. Said another way, old wineskins cannot contain new wine. Now, let me explain this. Some of you may have bottles in your house, but you don't have wine skins. Does anybody have a wine skin in their house? Okay, let me explain it. In Bible times, you notice the picture on the screen, that's a picture of a wine skin. They would squeeze the grape or squeeze the fruit, whatever the fruit is, and they would put the juice in the wine skin. Let's use grapes as an example. When you squeeze grapes, it's called fresh grape juice. What is it called? Fresh grape juice, meaning that's the best time to drink it, when it's fresh. It hasn't fermented yet. But fruits have a tendency, it's a natural thing they do, they ferment. And when fruits ferment, they begin to give off what is called a gas, like they begin to expand. So the wineskins, if the wineskins are new and the fruit begins to ferment, the wineskins begin to stretch. And if it's new, it will stretch as the wine ferments. Are you following me? But what happens if they put new wine in old wineskins? Let me explain the old wineskins. A skin becomes old because more than once, more than twice, more than three times, wine was poured into this leather skin. And what happens when it's poured into the leather skin naturally absorbs. What word did I just say? Absorbs. Like a sponge, the wine begins to sink into the leather skins, and the leather skins absorb it. And when it dries up, it gets hard. When you put more, it gets harder. When you continue putting wine that ferments and dries up, it gets to the point of brittle, and then it could break. So along comes someone and they put new wine in the old wine skins, and before they know it, the wine begins to ferment and it begins to expand. It begins to fill the wine skin with gas, and before you know it, what happens? The wine skin breaks. The wine skin bursts. Now let me make an application. Why is this application so significant? Here it is. Evangelism tends to focus on new teachings, but rarely on new natures. Follow this. When you try to put new teachings into a person's mind and their lives are not changed, just like the wineskins, they can only hold on to that for a certain amount of time, but if they are not changed, what happens? And when we use the phrase expand, when the beliefs begin to expand in their minds and their natures are not changed, what happens? It destroys their experience. And before you know it, you say, whatever happened to so-and-so? Whatever happened to that brother? Whatever happened to that sister? Well, what was happening is as they begin to process these new teachings, they were not able to handle this understanding and it destroyed their experience. So what has to happen here? New doctrines will destroy old wineskins. Said very simply, if you try to teach someone a new way of living or a new doctrine or a new subject, they may understand it, but when they try to live it out in their lives, until their lives are changed, it's just a matter of time before that new teaching challenges that old nature and it destroys their experience. So what do we have to do? Here it is. We cannot change our fruit until we change our what? Our root. What does that mean? Don't expect anything new to show up on the outside until there is a new connection on the inside. Look at this very carefully. The root system is below the ground. You don't see the root system. It's the hidden part of your life. What you see are the fruits. That's why the Bible says, by their fruits you'll know them. But the hidden system is below the surface, which means whatever is nourishing you, are you following me carefully? Whatever is nourishing you will eventually show up on the outside of your life. Now, what's the challenge? In our world today, we live in a world that wants to naturally nourish us. It wants to nourish us with media, with the internet, with television, with the reading material, with music, with entertainment. And if that is our root system and we're drawing from that consistently, it's going to show up on the outside. So if you want your life to be different, what has to be different? Your root system has to draw from a living source in order to present living fruit on the outside. But here's the conflict. Here's the conflict. I want you to notice this. And I'm teaching, I'm not preaching tonight, but here's the conflict. Let's look at this for a moment. And we're going to find out, we live in the center. Let me see if I could do this. We live in the center. This yellow circle here represents us. This is who we are when we come to Jesus. We have a nature that's corrupt. We'll find that out what the scripture says tonight. That is our nature. So what we tend to think is we said, well, if we can surround that person with doctrines and teachings and beliefs in the Bible, if we can fill them with scriptures from the Bible, maybe all of that information will accomplish transformation. So what we do, honey, do you have a set of those lessons with you? Do you have any of those lessons with you? One set, maybe. Let me get that set. Just give me a book or anything. Okay, so what we do is we take a lesson. Here it is. Okay, I'll just use this. So what we do is we say, here's a lesson, and then every night we give them another lesson. And another lesson, and another lesson, and another lesson. And we say, read this and follow it. But what they fail to realize is we're surrounding them with doctrines that's blocking their way to Jesus. I want you to follow me carefully. So this formula brings this Asian young man into a conflict. I tried to find an Asian from Singapore to put his picture there. So he looks at the doctrines and he wonders, can I live in harmony with those doctrines? But the problem is, say this with me, he has a what? A corrupt nature. His nature. And we're going to talk about that in a moment. I'll show you this. I made this statement, but I'm going to show you what the Bible says about our nature when we come to the Lord. His nature then tries to live in harmony with these doctrines, but he hasn't met Jesus yet. And until you meet Jesus, you'll see this all week long, until you get to know Jesus first, you will never be able to live in harmony with the doctrines until you get to know Jesus first. Because he is the source of all of the power that we need in order to live in harmony with the teachings in his word. Now, somebody told me a few days ago, don't expect amens in Singapore, so I'm not going to ask for any. I'm just going to go ahead and teach like nobody's there. Until you find Jesus first, you cannot live in harmony with the doctrines. Just want to see if you were there. So let's look at this. So you notice, this is us. And by the way, don't fool yourself. We are all born corrupt. Every one of us. Have you ever seen a baby cry? When you miss their feeding time? Have you heard of the phrase, terrible twos? When a baby gets to 2 years old, you can't stop them from touching everything. And you see them in the store, they have a temper tantrum. Have you seen that? Was your child like that? And you see them hit the mommy and hit the daddy, and you think, I'm glad they're not 25 years old. You see, there's a reason why the Bible says, here it is, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. If your baby was born at 20 years old, he would be too much for you to handle. So the Lord allows children to be born small so that we can train them in the way that they should go, because they have corrupt natures. Their natures are so unregenerated that that nature would destroy you if it was the same size you were. For example, is there anyone here tonight that's been bitten by a dog? Raise your hand. Oh, you got bitten by a dog? You got bitten by a dog? You got bitten by a dog? Anybody over here got bitten by a dog? You got bitten by a dog? I got bitten by a dog. The worst dog bite I ever got was from a poodle. The poodle's name was Samson. I should have known better. I mean, if you name, it was a cute little white poodle. And I thought, well, you know, a cute little white poodle must be a cute little white poodle. If you're going to pet any poodle or any dog, you can pet a cute little white poodle. But I didn't know that that poodle wasn't cute when it was eating its food. So what I did is I walked over to that poodle while it was eating, and I petted that, I held him in my arms before, I played with him, but I never knew, listen to me carefully, I never knew what was inside of that poodle until I tried to pet him. The only warning I got was, and I thought, well, he's probably a little upset, but I didn't pay any attention. And I reached down to pick up that, to pet that poodle. It was, that poodle was so small, he grabbed onto my finger and I lifted him up as I was trying to get him off my finger. And the owner, I said to the owner, why didn't you tell me that that poodle would bite me? And she said, oh, he will only bite you if you touch him when he's eating. Did I know that? Here's my point. Some people are really nice until you touch them at the wrong moment, and then they turn into a vicious poodle. Here's my illustration. They look harmless on the outside. They look so cute. She's so pretty. He is so handsome. But what you don't know, below that handsome surface, he's a devil. And below that pretty surface, she's dangerous. So we often tend to gauge people on what we see. But tonight we're going to learn, don't judge a book by its cover. Look at this. How did we get that way? How do we have the potential to be vicious and mean and angry and hostile? Where does this temper to come from, people being evil and murder and jealous? Where does it all come from? So let's ask the question, how did we get into this quandary? The word quandary means, how did we get into this mess? So let's start with the blessing. Anytime you come to the Lord, He always wants to bless you. When God made Adam and Eve, He had a blessing in store for them. Let's look at this. Let's start with the blessing. And we go to Genesis chapter 1 and verse 29, the blessing. Here it is. God speaking to Adam. And God said, see, I have given you every herb that yields seed, which is on the face of all the earth, and every tree whose fruit yields seed, to you it shall be for food. So how much did God give to Adam? Every tree, as far as Adam could see, God gave Adam every tree. How many trees? Now, how would you feel if you went outside of the church and God said to you, every building in Singapore is yours? Would you feel good about that? Let's go a step further, because I know most of you don't have cars. How would you feel if God said to you, every car in Singapore is yours, would you feel good about it? God balances His blessings with a warning. And what amazes me, when we look back at the story of Adam and Eve, we wonder, God was giving him everything. Why was he so dissatisfied? The blessing came with a warning. Let's look at the warning. Genesis chapter 2 and verse 17. It starts with the first word. What's the first word? But. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat. For in the day you eat of it, you shall surely, what's going to happen? You will surely die. Now you would think when you read that, and we've said this before, I mean, people have asked me the question over and over and over again. They've said to me, why did Adam decide to be disobedient when God gave him everything? Here's my answer. The same reason you decide to be disobedient. We are just like our father Adam. God can give us all the blessings in the world, but there's something within us that wants more than what God gives. Now let's go to the next one. So in order for God to continue to bless Adam, the purpose for the tree was a test. Let's look at the test, the third thing. So the test comes, God gives Adam a wife, and her name is Eve. So Eve is in the garden, wandering during the day, and the test comes. Here it is. Genesis 3 and verse 1. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? This is very important, and I want you to get this. The very first test didn't come because of the fruit. It came, he said, has God said? He tested Eve on the basis of God's word. Most of the tests you face as a Christian will be based on whether or not you know what God's word says. If you don't know what God's word says, then the devil comes to you and says, did God really say that you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? Well, you know what happened? She made a choice. Let me say this, and I want you to repeat. We all have choices. Can we say that together? We all have choices. Every day you make a choice. Every moment of every day you make a choice. You choose to do good, you choose to do evil. You choose to tell the truth, you choose to tell a lie. You choose to be honest, you choose to be dishonest. We wonder, where does this come from? This is the reason for the topic tonight, human nature. So she had a choice to make. Here is how she got to the choice. Genesis 3 and verse 6. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. She also gave to her husband with her, and what did he do? Those three words, and he ate. Now I want you to share, I'm going to share this with you. Every one of us, this entire world, was plunged into trouble on those last three words, and he ate. What were those three words? And he ate. If those words were not there, we would all be just fine. The temptation didn't come because she presented the fruit to him. The temptation came because, and he ate. We all have choices to make. And the choice you make determines the outcome of your life. And this is something that is so significant to the development of human nature. Every choice has a consequence. If Adam could eat that fruit and there was no consequences, then the statement that God made to him was not the truth. The Lord told him, on the day you eat of it, what's going to happen? You're going to surely die. Let's look at the fifth point, the results. The results. Look at this. Genesis 3 and verse 7. Then the eyes of both of them were what? Opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves what? Coverings. Here's the next point. Whenever we go against God's word, in His eyes, we are naked. We lose the covering of God's righteousness. We lose the blessing. We are clear and open before God. There's nothing hidden when we disobey God. But now let's keep going. The Lord saw Adam and Eve in a difficult situation. What I like about God, He did not leave them in a hopeless situation. You see, tonight as we begin our week together, I want you to know two things. We make bad choices, but God always comes after us and gives us another chance. We may find ourselves in difficulty, but God never leaves us in difficulty. We may make a terrible decision, but God always has an answer to the worst decisions we make. I'm not going to ask for amens. I'm just going to make some crazy moves, and you know what I mean. So the Lord sees Adam and Eve in a difficult situation, and what I love about God is no matter how bad we are, God is always good. Always good. He doesn't leave us. He's not like some people that say to you, good for you. You know, sometimes we do something that our parents told us not to do. They said, good for you. Go to your room. That's not God. Amen. God doesn't say, good for you. Now you know what I mean. No. When Adam and Eve fell, God knew that they needed help. So let's go to the sixth point, the inquiry. I love this about God. We're talking about human nature. Genesis 3, verse 8 and 9. And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, that is toward the evening. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. That's crazy. Is there any place that we can hide from God? There's no place that we can hide from God. But here's the inquiry. My brother, could you bring me down just a touch? Because I feel like, Aman, could you bring me down just a touch? Just a touch, just a little bit, bring me down just a touch. Appreciate it. That's a little better. Thank you. Thank you, that's good, much better. So the Lord comes to Adam and Eve, and look what He does. This is the inquiry. And the Lord God called to Adam and said to him, what are the last three words? Where are you? Here's a big point you don't want to miss. Every decision you make in life is going to take you somewhere. It's going to take you in a good direction, or it's going to take you in a bad direction. It's going to take you in the direction of failure or the direction of success. It's going to take you in the direction of sadness or the direction of happiness. Every decision we make, every choice that we exercise, takes us in one direction or the other. But here's the good news. Whatever direction it takes you, God can find you. There's no place you can hide from God. So here they are in the garden hiding. Now you would think at this moment, this is the perfect opportunity. This is the perfect opportunity for Adam to fix what he messed up. But now this brings me to another part of human nature. Look at it. Let's say it together. What is it called? The blame game. You know what gets me? Most of you would probably say you are not responsible for what happens in your life. That's natural. If I had a better supervisor, if my parents were different, if I had a better girlfriend, if my wife was nicer, if my kids would listen to me. Most of us don't like to take any responsibility for where we are. Now, how do we get that way? That's exactly how our parents were. So the Lord comes to the garden. He's asking Adam, where is he? And look what Adam says. So he said, I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was what? Naked. And I did what? Hid myself. Once again, there's no place we can hide from the Lord. And look what God did. He continues to ask questions. And he said, that is, God said, speaking to Adam, who told you that you were naked? Did God know the answer? Yes, he did. But why did he ask the question? Here's the reason why. He wants us to understand the process of our dilemma. Like they would do in court. How did the accident occur? How did you get to the place where you robbed the bank? Why are your relationships falling apart? God asks, who told you that you were naked? He continues the question. Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you that you should not eat? Let me ask you, did God know the answer? Did he know the answer? But he's walking Adam through a process. Here's why this subject is so important to me. Some of us like to avoid the process. We say, okay, I did it. Forgive me. Oh, it was not that simple. God said, Adam, I'm taking you somewhere, but I've got to help you see where you are so you can appreciate where I'm taking you. Until we realize that we are where we are because of decisions we make, we could never appreciate how God can turn a bad situation into a good situation. So God is saying, Adam, where are you? So now Adam could have said, Lord, you know what? I am so sorry. I should not have eaten of that tree. I know you told me not to do it. You told me I'm going to die. I should have listened to you. I'm so sorry, Lord. Is that what Adam did? Listen to this, ladies. I always like to read this because the ladies always wonder, what was Adam's problem? Then the man said, this is crazy. The woman you gave me. You see, watch this. God, if you didn't put me in a situation like this, if you gave me a different woman, I wouldn't be in this trouble. You know what's happening right away? Adam is taking no responsibility for his condition. I'm going to ask you the question, but no answer. How many times have you been in a situation? I want you to be honest with yourself. How many times have you been in a situation that you know you had something to do with where you are, but you chose not to take responsibility and you blame the other person? At one point or another, we've all done that. You might wonder where you got that from. We got that from Adam. The woman you gave to be with me, she gave me of the tree and I ate. Now, watch this. I want you to grab this. She did give him of the tree, didn't she? Did she give him of the tree? Come say yes. Did he have to eat it? At the very end, he finally told the truth about himself. Nobody can force you to do anything. You've got to choose how your story is going to end. And I ate. And he ate, then he says, and I ate. But now, God's not done. And the Lord God said to the woman, what is this that you have done? Did he know? He knew. And the Bible says, the woman said, the serpent deceived me and I ate. Are you seeing what's going on here? I'm talking about human nature. Human nature does not like to take responsibility for its own actions. Every one of us has a part of that in us. We are quick to blame somebody. We are quick to point out what somebody else has done. But very few of us would say to our supervisor, it was my reason why the machine broke. It was my reason why the bills were not paid. We always like to say, the woman you gave me, the serpent, Lord. But what I'm going to share with you this week, the best way to begin to move in the right direction is to take personal responsibility for your own decisions. Can I get an amen? It's not a bad thing. You know why it's a good thing? Because failure is not a problem. It's remaining a failure that's the problem. Doing evil is not something you should do, but it's not the end of life if you decide to take that situation, learn from it, and make a solid decision to move in the opposite direction. We're going to find out how that happens. What amazes me about this, friends, is the woman blamed the serpent, and what did the serpent say? The serpent didn't say anything. He took the blame because he knows that he was the reason that the temptation even began. Even though he tempted them, temptation is not sin. Let's say that together. Temptation is not sin. We're going to be tempted all the time, but you don't have to yield to the temptation. Why is this so vitally important? In the world we live today, temptations are intensifying on the internet, on Instagram, on Facebook, on Twitter, on Snapchat. The list goes on and on and on. The society you live in, the music you watch, the places you go, the people you're with, temptations are all around us. But in order for us to be able to grow in our relationship, first of all, with each other and with God, we got to make decisions that we will not eat, because the outcome is never positive. It's always negative when it goes against the warnings of Scripture. But tonight there's some good news. There's some very good news. Here it is. The promise. What I love about the Lord, He sees our predicament, but He doesn't leave us there. Isn't that good news? Isn't that good news? You see, some of your parents would leave you in jail. Let him stay in jail until he pays his own debt. God will see us in the worst of circumstances, and He'll always offer us a way out. Isn't that good news? Oh, that's okay. I'm getting used to it. I'm going to go back home to New York, back to Thompsonville, and I'm going to be shocked if my church says amen. I'm going to say, you need to go to Singapore. Just having fun with you. The Lord saw them in the worst situation. He did not reverse the consequences, but He said, I've got some good news for you. Things are not going to always be this way. It's going to be a long time. So let's watch this tonight. We are all in the predicament that we're in because of what took place in that garden thousands and thousands of years ago. The world is the way it is because of what took place in that garden. But God did not leave them there. He did not leave us without a promise that He can turn it around. Here it is. Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15. Looking at the serpent, looking at the woman, He decides to make a pact. He says, I will put enmity between you and the woman. He's looking at the serpent. He's saying, I'm going to put a roadblock between you and the woman. And by the way, the word there, enmity, you know what it means? It means an uncomfortable feeling. That means when you're about to do something wrong, there's a feeling that you get just before you do something wrong, that if you pay attention to that feeling you get, it is a warning system that God built into every one of us to say, don't do it, don't go there, don't make that choice. It's when you ignore that, it's like that still small voice saying, don't do that. And when you ignore it, you find yourself in the garden blaming someone else. The Lord looked at the serpent, He said, I will put enmity, I will put discomfort between you and the woman. And what does that mean? That means I'm going to work so that the woman hates you and you hate the woman. Because they had a conversation before that caused the woman to be deceived. Today we're living in the end where the Lord has worked for thousands of years to create in His church a hatred for evil. But look at why he did it. And he says, between your seed and her seed, and he shall bruise your head, that is, Jesus will have victory over the devil, and in that victory, and you shall bruise his heel. This simply means that when Jesus gave his life to turn the world around, he only wounded his heel. But the good news is, he stepped on the devil's head. Can we say that? He crushed the serpent. He made sure that he defeated the serpent so that you and I don't have to face circumstances in life that defeat us. Oh, I'm glad tonight because I know I've faced a lot of circumstances that defeated me. I've faced a lot of difficulties where I stumbled, but the good news is God did not leave me there. He always comes and finds a way and offers us a way out. But who are we today and how do we get here? So the question is, what happened at the fall that condemns us? This is what happened in that garden. This is how we all are who we are. Here's the answer. Romans 5 and verse 12. Therefore, just as through how many men? One man, sin into the world, and death came in through sin, and thus death spread to all men because all sinned. This doesn't mean that a baby did something wrong as soon as it came out. This simply means the baby came out with a nature that condemns it to death unless something transpires to change that child's nature. We are all condemned to death unless something transpires to change our nature. Are you following? Are you tracking? Through one man, sin entered the world, and death through sin. And just like smoke filling a room, everybody was affected by the entrance of sin. Everybody. And here's a very important point I want you to grab. Education can't save you from sin. Money can't save you from sin. Possessions can't save you from sin. Fame cannot save you from sin. All the things that you have in your life, all the positions you've ever had in occupation cannot change your circumstances. Only Jesus can save you from sin. So here it is. Let's look at the results of disobedience. We're going to see this tonight in our closing. The results of disobedience. What does the Bible tell us now? Romans 3 and verse 23. For all sinned, all have sinned and fall what? Short of the glory of God. What that means is without the Lord in our lives, we will make the best attempts at doing something well, but we'll always fall short. We'll never be able to accomplish anything good without the help of the Lord. We all fall short. And this is not because you don't know how to try. This means in your best effort, you'll always fall short of reaching the goal that you want to attain without the power and the strength of the Lord. But now, let's look at something I told you. We're going to now take the heart scan. Are you ready for the heart scan? We're going to do a heart check. How does the Bible describe the impact of sin? Okay, you ready? You ready? You ready to see yourself? I hope you are. Let's look at the condition of the heart. You know, a lot of people say, oh, I have a good heart. I'm not going to look at you. That's a lie. Nobody has a good heart. Naturally speaking, here's what the scriptures say, Jeremiah 17:9. This is who we really are. The heart is deceitful above how many things? All things, and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Now, when Jeremiah said that, Jeremiah was comparing the heart to wild beasts, vicious animals, everything that walked the earth. And Jeremiah said, there's something worse than a vicious poodle. There's something worse than a vicious snake. It's the human heart. And what's even worse than having a deceitful heart that's desperately wicked, it is also unpredictable. You never know. You never know. You might say, I never expected. Have you ever known somebody that you said, I didn't see that coming? I don't know, I might have known him for 30 years. I would never expect that from him. The heart is unpredictable. That nature we have, it's unpredictable. But now let's go from the heart to the character impact. What kind of character do we have? Are we good people? Look at Psalm 14, verse 3. Here it is. They have all done what? Turned aside. They have together become what? Corrupt. There is none who does what? Good. No, not one. Ooh, relax. It's going to get better. Right now we're in the doctor's office getting a thorough checkup from the neck up. The prognosis is terrible spiritually, but there is some medication that can change it. I'll tell you about that in a moment. So we have corrupt hearts, we have corrupt characters. Nobody in our family is good, including us. Oh, man. Whew. Let's keep going. Tighten your seatbelts. What about the moral impact? What kind of people are there in the world? Maybe we might find ourselves in this list. Galatians 5, verse 19 to 21. Tonight is the complete exam, the moral impact. Now the works of the flesh are evident, which are, together, adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousy, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambition, dissension, that is difficulty between one another, heresy, envy, murder, Lord have mercy, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in time past, that those who, what's the very next word, practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Whew, that's a list and a half, isn't it? It's a horrible list. But you know what's amazing about that list? It says, these are the kind of people that won't be in heaven when you get there. I'm glad for that. But that's what God has to save us from. We might have found ourselves in that list. Let's keep going. What about the moral impact on the world? Paul talked about the moral impact in his own life. He looked at himself and he said these words in Romans 7, verse 18. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, what are the next three words? Nothing good dwells. And then he says, for to will is present with me. In other words, I want to do what's right, but how to perform what is good, I do not find. Here's my point. You may have heard people say, if you just look deep within, you can do anything. There are gurus, and there are these people that are, if you just hum long enough, you could become good. Look for the butterfly and follow its path, and you'll find the place of goodness. Phooey. That's a lie. If you concentrate and go long enough, you'll find the good in you. Ain't nothing good about you. I'm going to say like they do in New York, ain't nothing good in you. No, there's nothing good in us. Paul says, I looked within me, I cannot find anything. He says, in me that is in my flesh, when I looked with the magnifying glass, I didn't find anything good. That's a checkup. That's the moral checkup. What about the world in which we live? What about all those people out there? The Bible says in Isaiah 24 and verse 5, the earth is also, what's the next word? Defiled under its inhabitants. Why? Because they have transgressed the laws, changed the ordinance, and broken the what? Everlasting covenant. The world is a mess. But I'm going to end on a positive note tonight. The world is a mess. Our hearts are a mess. Our characters are a mess. Our morals are a mess. We try to do good. We cannot do it. What about the impact of sin? Paul said it in Romans 7, 17, but now it is no longer I who do it. Now I want you to remember this. This is going to be significant during the week. It is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells where? Say it together. There's something in you that you'll find out about this week. It's very significant. Paul is saying, I don't want to do that, but there's something in me that keeps me doing what I don't want to do. And then he finally says in Romans 7, verse 24, oh, wretched man that I am, who will do what, friends? Deliver me. Every one of us needs deliverance. Just checking. Every one of us needs deliverance. You cannot be delivered by education. You cannot be delivered by wealth. You cannot be delivered by status. You might live on the top floor of the most beautiful penthouse in Singapore. You need deliverance. If we could be delivered by something we do, then we don't need Jesus. Then he died in vain. So let's look at the default of human nature. There is a default of human nature, and here it is. And here it is. This is what happened. And this is the entrance into tomorrow night. We're going to just lay the foundation right now. So look at, we're a mess. Say that with me. We are a mess. Okay, let's just fix that. Say, I am a mess. Oh, didn't that hurt? Oh, I better stop right there. Because you might leave here feeling awful about yourself. What I want you to do, like a doctor said, now I'm going to get you some medication. Take your medication. We're going to find out what the medication is before we end tonight, all right? So look at the default of human nature. Adam sins, Eve is deceived, but something happens now. This is a very pivotal point in my close tonight. Something happens that keeps this cycle of evil alive. Look at Genesis chapter 3, verse 16. To the woman, he said, that is God speaking to Eve, I will greatly multiply your sorrow and your conception. In pain you shall bring forth children. Ladies, that's the reason why when you have a baby, it's very painful because of what Eve did. But look at this part. Your desire shall be for your what? Husband, and he shall do what? Rule over you. I'm going to just hit this very quickly and let it go. What kind of husband was Adam? Ladies, what kind of husband was Adam? Here's the kind of husband he was. He blamed his wife rather than taking responsibility. Now, you would think after he blames his wife, she would not desire him. But the Lord said, your desire shall be for your husband. And this man that just blamed her, the Lord said, and he is going to rule over you. When somebody rules you, that means you don't have a choice. We're going to find out, the next topic is about desire. We're going to find out how powerful this statement is. Your desire shall be for your husband. Why do I have a desire for a man that does nothing but evil to me? And how long is he going to rule over me? Let me end tonight on a positive note. Our only hope. Here is our only hope. Matthew 1, verse 21. She will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name, let's say it together, Jesus. What will he do? He will save his people from their sins. What do we say? Amen to that. So let's look at the chart now. Look at the chart that we had in the beginning. Look at the chart. When Jesus comes into your life, a changed nature, because you met Jesus first. When you meet Jesus first, you don't have a problem with his doctrines. But if you start with doctrines, you won't know Jesus. But if you start with Jesus, there's something he'll give you that doctrines can never give you. Doctrines can give you information, but Jesus can give you what? Transformation. See, friends, this whole week we're going to talk about information versus transformation. So tomorrow night, we're going to begin with the second component. What's the second component? Say it together. Desire. What is the question? What role does desire fulfill in human nature? I don't want you to miss it. Tonight was the worst presentation. It's going to get better from this point on. So if you're going to miss any night, it should have been tonight. But since you didn't miss it, you got to come back tomorrow night. What role does desire fulfill in human nature? Friends, I don't just want information. I want transformation. Is there somebody tonight that just doesn't want information, but they want transformation? Is there somebody here tonight? You mean you want your heart to stay corrupt? You want to remain evil and wicked? So let me try that one more time. I know you guys probably didn't hear the question. How many want transformation? So tonight I want to pray that when you leave here tonight, you might go home and say, man, that pastor made me feel uncomfortable. Well, I was playing the role of a spiritual doctor tonight. I want us to understand where we are without Jesus, because from this point on, we're going to see where we can be with Jesus. Let's pray together. Our loving Father, our gracious God, Lord, this world is a mess. Without you, our lives are a mess. Our minds are filled with corruption. And this world wants to enhance that corruption and make it even more deep and dark and more corrupt. But Father, there's a lot of information. Everybody wants to inform us. But Jesus, you came not just to inform us, you came to transform us. May we say, Lord, I need a different life. I need a stronger life. I need a better walk with you. And when we have that deep desire, we will find out how we can have a growing, thriving relationship of deliverance from sin and its power. So, Lord, thank you for teaching us, but take us to our homes tonight. May we ponder what we've learned, and may we come back tomorrow evening to learn even more of how to go from information to transformation. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.